By the way, you won't see it now. My name is Jack, and I'll be chatting to you today on this little tour of the Black Forest. Our driver this morning, ladies and gentlemen, a man called Miroslav. Now, I don't know if you can call him Miro if you like. I don't know if you're aware of this, but he is renowned. Miro is renowned as the greatest driver in the whole of Western Europe. So put your hands up. A round of applause. This morning, thank you very much. And as I say, that's the Rhine River to the right of us. People are taking their dogs for a walk, and it's quite wide, a river, quite high still, as you can see, but it is beginning to go down. So we are hoping for some semblance of normality fairly soon here, but it might take a little bit of time. Anyway, we're headed for the Black Forest. There's a city to our left, by the way. It's called Breisach, on the eastern banks of the Rhine here. Breisach, a little city, 16,500 inhabitants, sitting with halfway between Colmar and France, which some of us will be fortunate enough to visit this afternoon, and Freiburg in Germany, which we'll pass through a little later on this morning. And it's about 15 miles away from those places and about 40 miles north of Basel in Switzerland. Now, some of you might know of Basel as Baal. But don't worry, both the same place. Baal is the French pronunciation and Basel the German. We tend to call it Basel over this side of the river, you see. And anyway, that's about 40 miles to the south. And this little city, Breisach, ahead of us now, the name Breisach goes back to Celtic times, you know, those Celts. You know those Celts. They were all over the place, and they came here as well about 3,500 years ago, actually. And they call it Breisach. Breisach actually meant breakwater or surrounded by water. That was the case, you know. You'll see a hill soon as we go around this roundabout now. Look to the left, a little bit to the left there. Can you see there's a cathedral on top of a hill? Can you see that hill?
Yes.
Cathedral up there now. And that's the Cathedral of St. Stephen's. And that hill on which it stands, it used to be surrounded by the waters of the Rhine River until this hydro engineer called Johann Gottfried Tuller, he came along in the middle of the 19th century and he straightened and narrowed the Rhine River so that people didn't have to paddle to work anymore. And they were very, very happy. And the Cathedral of St. Stephen's, named after the first Christian martyr, it's a work starting on that cathedral, you know, at the end of the 12th century. And it continued until the end of the 15th century. 300 years it took to build that cathedral. I think they were working on the principle of one brick a day. And then they go home for a beer. I thought it was a little fib. The fact of the matter is, you know, these buildings very often took hundreds of years to build. Work was suspended for anything up to 100 years because of wars, because of lack of funds, because of diseases like the plague decimating large numbers of the population. I'll come back to that in a minute, but first of all, look to the left and you'll see that ugly building there. Look at it. God, that's ugly, isn't it? It's neither Romanesque nor... Miroslav wants to stop with it. It is the a very important building, actually. It's the Badische Wein Centrum. And it's the biggest wine storage complex in the whole of Europe. Look at it over there. Look, full of wine. Imagine being stuck in there all night. It's the stuff of nightmares, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. But Mira might be stopped on the way back. All right, fine. All right. Anyway, the Badische Weinzer. Anyway, good. It's the third biggest in the whole of the world. Whole of the world, actually. There are two bigger ones on this planet. One of them is in South Africa, and the other one, California. California, of course. And good, wonderful. Back to that cathedral, took 300 years to build. It has in this case, you know, resulted in the fact that the two towers of St. Stephen's Cathedral there were built in totally different architectural styles. The first one having been built in the old Romanesque style of architecture, whereas the second one was built in the later Gothic style of architecture. And Yes, I don't know whether you might have a chance to pay a visit. Well worth a visit. It has survived the centuries, survived the Second World War as well, just about. Was very damaged during the Second World War. At one point they were wondering whether they'd bother to rebuild it at all. Eventually they did. Restored it to its former glory. You'd find there are frescoes. If you did pay a visit, you'd find a magnificent wooden carved altar piece by a man called Hans Roy, and also some frescoes by Martin Schongauer, all of which go back to the 15th century. And they have somehow survived, and well worth a visit, should you have the time or the and the inclination to do so. Breisach itself, you know, has a very turbulent history behind it as well. Over the centuries, at different periods of time, it's belonged to the French, to the Prussians, the Austrians, the Holy Roman Empire over here. And then in 1805, Breisach became a part of the newly established state of Baden here in southwest Germany. And in 1952 it was that Baden was merged with the neighboring state of Württemberg. So we find ourselves now in the state of Baden-Württemberg. It is a bit of a mouthful, I know, but I'm sure if you practice amongst yourselves, you'll be fine by lunchtime. Baden-Württemberg, yes. Good. We, as we travel along here now, you see there's a group of hills to our left. And ahead of us here, it's a volcanic group of hills. It's called the Kaiserstuhl. It has one of the warmest climates in. And we're traveling around, driving along the southern end now. And you'll find that the south and southern slopes and the western slopes, especially covered in vines, other parts of the Kaiserstuhl are also famous for their rare species of plants, including 35 different kinds of orchids can be found on this little group of hills, the Kaiserstuhl, to our left. Now that we've just entered our first village here in the Rhine Valley, and this is the village of Ehringen. Ehringen. And let me tell you, Ehringen is the capital of Germany.
That's where you live.
Do I sense that some of you don't believe me? All right. You're right in thinking. It's not, of course, the state capital of Germany, but it is the sunshine capital of Germany, you know, because they've discovered after years of research that this little village here has more sunshine hours than anywhere else in the whole of Germany. And the sun is out to prove it today. It also gives us a chance to have a look at village life at 8:30 on a Monday morning. And as you can see, it's absolutely buzzing here. Life in its essence. And there's some roadworks going on here now, so are we going to have to take, we're going to have to go up there. We're going to have to take some detour diversions, you know, and you're going to see a part of Ehringen that nobody, no other tourists have ever seen in their lives. These are the Badlands of Ehringen. And there's the church there on the right hand side. And yes, not much happening in these villages, you know, and rather quiet they are, you know. And interesting. If you could see somebody. She didn't like me, I don't think. Anyway, let us continue. If you went to look, these are the back streets of Ehringen. Now, if you went along the main street, you'll find that it was covered, full of hotels, restaurants, guest houses, catering for the tourist industry. You know, these little villages, they're very popular, actually, amongst our visitors. They're great places to spend as a base for day trips into the Black Forest, over the river there to France. Switzerland is not so far away, and they're pretty little villages in their own right. And but they do tend to be a little bit sleepy, some of these villages. So if I may give you a word of advice, if you do see somebody waving from the side of the road, wave back at them. You're probably the most exciting thing that'll happen this week. Have a little sympathy. Okay, good. Now then, we're heading for the Black Forest, of course. There's a tractor. Oh, a tractor. Look out for the tractors. You get some big ones, small ones. Sometimes you get medium-sized tractors as well. Really watch out for them. Anyway, we're heading for the Black Forest. Not everyone, you know, is aware of the fact that the Black Forest is situated on a group of hills, on a mountain range. We're going to have to climb up into the Black Forest. And there can be quite a temperature difference between that here. It's good. I think so. We can expect it perhaps to be 1 or 2 degrees cooler up there in the Black Forest, but here in the Rhine Valley, you know, the climate is certainly influenced by the Mediterranean, which is about 6 or 7 hours drive to the south from here, and this combined with a good soil temperature, warm soil temperature, it allows for an 8-month growing season and a wide variety of fruit and vegetables. The sandy soil around here, ideal for the local delicacy. You know what it is? Schnapps. Well, that's one of them. But you should eat something from time to time as well, and it is asparagus.
Oh.
Asparagus. It's we come to the end of the asparagus season now. You'll see some of the fields soon. At the same time, asparagus season comes in June, July.
Okay.
Well, it's on the right hand side. Yeah. Right on the right hand side. Yeah. Right, those humps, those long humps, those are the asparagus fields, and they are covered in blue, black, or white plastic before being harvested. They don't see the light of day. That's why they remain white. You see, they don't go through the process of photosynthesis, don't turn green. Asparagus, strawberries are, when the strawberries are finished, it's time for the cherries. In their time come the apples and the pears and the peaches and the plums. An old field of asparagus there on the right hand side there. The corn is growing now, the maize. I realize that some of you are from Britain. Corn is growing, maize. Later on, sunflowers will be there to be seen as well. Grains include wheat, barley, rye. Vegetables, we have potatoes, cabbage, Brussels sprouts. If there's anything more happening here than there was in the last
village of Voss and Violet.
But I can't say I'm particularly
Voss and Violet.
You know, I have my theory, they're all recuperating from the weekend, you see. The nightlife in these villages, absolutely scintillating. But notice the flower decorations, of course. Storks, we look out for storks as well. And football, somebody mentioned football. Just slow down here, Nero, please. Look up there on the left-hand side. Can you see the stork's nest up there on top of that hill? Downstairs, a stork inside it as well. We're going to see, for those of you who missed it, there'll be another one to be seen in a few minutes' time. And, yes, you know, there's a stork. See the stork on the left-hand side there? If you see a wooden stork, a picture of a stork, with a little bundle held in its beak, of course, it means that a new addition has been added to the family in recent weeks, or will be very soon. A baby's on the way, anyway. Good. Flower decorations, they do love their flower decorations here. One other building I'd like to draw your attention to before we leave this little village of Vars and Weiler. It is directly ahead of us. Can you see it? It's a little chapel. It's on the left there. A little chapel, and we're going to see lots of those in the Black Forest, and I'll tell you more about them then. But other things to talk about first of all, that building there on the left hand side, that's the Vars and Weiler Winzer. The local wine cooperative around here, and see, most of the wine growers around here, they won't make their own wine. They'll bring their harvested grapes to the wine cooperative, you see, and it will then be produced and bottled as the village wine. Look ahead of us, there's a field of flowers. They aren't quite there. I think they're going to be gladioli, are they? Might they be? No, they're not. They're going to be something else. Where do I talk? Where do I pretend to know about these? I don't know. Anyway, but you do get these fields of flowers dotted all around the Rhine Valley here, you know, and they are there so that you can go and pick flowers whenever you need. It's a wonderful thing, and there's nobody there to take any money from you. But there is a box. And you know that box? You notice they are either partially or entirely covered in solar panels, some of these houses. I'll tell you a little bit more about alternative sources of energy later on. Gottenheim's the name of the village, by the way. They're the home of the gods, but it's not only home to the gods, you know, it's also home to a couple of friends of mine. And I hope they'll be in. If not, at least you'll be able to see their house. It's not really a house. It's not a house really at all. It's just a... It's a nest. Oh, maybe you can see it now. It's a nest. It's another stork's nest. And you'll see it very shortly. It'll be up on the hill, a little bit way up the hill on the right-hand side. And look out for them, it'll be another stork's nest, and both Mama and Papa are there this morning for us. And the little ones, the young, there they are. Can you see that player on the right-hand side? You see, he's standing, one of them are standing on the camera, which is all forever pointing there. And Mama's there, and those might be the young ones, actually. Those are I think the ones below are the younger storks. You can see they're a little bit smaller, and they will have to grow fairly quick, you know, because they're going to have to fly down to Spain in August. They've only just been born, poor things, those storks, you know, wonderful birds. They only spend their summer here, you know. They come here in March, and they'll rear their young, and they'll leave in August, and they'll fly down south to warmer climes. They'll fly down to Spain, most of them. Some of them fly as far as Africa. It has been known for some storks to fly all the way down to South Africa, believe it or not. It's a wonderful, a long and hazardous flight, but they'll, next March, you know, they'll return here to this part of Germany where they came from, and they'll get back to exactly the same nest, which they left 6 or 7 months before. And amazing, the sense of direction they have, who knows how they do it. Very much loved they are as well, the storks around here. They almost died out, you know, in the 19th century. It was caused by pollution. River pollution. If you pollute the rivers, you know, you pollute the fish and the frogs, and they play a very important part in the storks' diet, and you end up polluting the storks themselves, and that's what happened. But the storks are thriving once again, though, and that's all for the best. And of course, after Venus, look how beautiful they are. Orange and yellow. Not quite as beautiful as tractors, but nonetheless. And this is followed by a fruit distribution plant there on the right-hand side.
Oh, yeah.
Distributing all that fruit to the supermarkets of the region. And this is followed by a very interesting company here on the right. They're called Gyriads, in fact. And what they produce there, they produce curtains. But not just any everyday curtains, they produce stage curtains for concert halls. And they have a very good reputation as well, and a worldwide distribution. And it could well be, you know, that in any of the great concert halls of the world, the New York Met, or the Sydney Opera House, or the Patti Pavilion in Swansea, you know, it could well be that those curtains were produced here in this little village of Umkirch, here in South Germany. Wonderful. Now then, ladies and gentlemen, look in the distance ahead of us and you will see a sign. It is a sign that might remind you of something that you've seen before. It says Aldi. Does it make you feel homesick?
No.
No, that's fair enough. I like an honest answer. But these Aldis, they are getting around. You know, these days they're to be found in the British Isles, in the in the United States, even Australia, you'll get these Aldi grocers, yeah, mostly. Sell some other things as well. But we were talking about those storks, weren't we? And I have to tell you this, ladies and gentlemen, when I talk about storks, when I hear about storks, I always, always have a terribly, terribly guilty feeling. It's the way we talk to our children. We say to our children, tell the truth. Don't you tell any lies, we say. But then we tell, what do? We turn to them and we tell them it's the storks that bring the babies. In their monasteries, they were avid wine growers, you know. The universities around here, they have their faculties of viticulture. There is a German wine institute. And if you travel to the city of Mainz, which is about 200 miles to the north from here, that's where you'll find the Ministry of Wine. And it does, show us what an important part of wine plays in the economy of this part of the world here. And of course these people, and the people around here, they love to get out and about. And you know the Germans' favorite leisure activity? It is hiking. They love to go out for a hike. If they don't go out for a hike, they go out cycling. But whether they go for a hike or a cycle, it's always good to have a destination, isn't it? They love to, one of their favorite destinations, you know, are the so-called Brühl Inns, the Straußenwirtschaften. Now, what they are, they're farms, you see, who are given a license to serve meals containing their own produce, their own vegetables, their own meat, and to serve their own wine. And it gives us, gives you the opportunity to visit a different location every time you go for a hike or a cycle, and to taste some of the local delicacies as well. It's a great tradition around here. The Straußenwirtschaften, the broom inns, always shown by the sign of the broom or a bunch of twigs outside. We might catch a glimpse of one a little later on.